There is little in common between us. You wander far from the graves of your ancestors, and seemingly without regret. Every part of this soil is sacred in the estimation of my people. Every hillside, every valley, every plain and grove has been hallowed by some sad or happy event in days long vanished. When the memory of my tribe shall have become a myth, these shores will swarm with the invisible dead that once filled them and still love this beautiful land. The white man will never be alone. There is no death, only a change of worlds.
Rivers, Majesty, filled with gold. A miracle. Mountains and hills, plains and pastures are fertile and beautiful. The harbors are unbelievably good. And there are many wide rivers, of which the majority contain gold. Rivers, Majesty, filled with gold. Your servant, Christopher Columbus.
Desolate wilderness, full of wild beasts and wild men, and what multitudes there might be of them, we know not.
Genesis, the first part, the 28th verse, the Lord's word. You shall have dominion over the fish of the sea, dominion over the birds of the heavens, over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Go forth, children, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it.
In such a wilderness, when we began to clear the land, with fire, with might and strength. Trees so thick and strong. We laid them all along, most furiously to ashes did confound.
As for the natives, they are near all dead of the smallpox. So the Lord hath cleared our title to what we possess. And we shall be the place where the Lord will create a new heaven and a new earth.
Sir, our lands were originally very good. But use and abuse have made them quite otherwise. We ruin the lands that are already cleared and either cut down more wood or just emigrate. Emigrate to the Western country.
The American. The forests and drains the marshes. The wilds become villages, and the villages, towns. The American, the daily witness of such wonders, does not see anything astonishing in all this destruction.
What good man would prefer a country covered with forests and ranged by a few thousand savages to our extensive republic, studded with cities and towns and prosperous farms, occupied by more than 12 million happy people?
Most men, it would seem to me, do not care for nature and would sell their share. Nowadays, almost all man's so-called improvements, as the building of houses and the cutting down of forests, simply deform the landscape. What is the use of a house, I ask, if you haven't got a tolerable planet to put it on?
When I think of these times and call back to my mind the grandeur and beauty of those almost uninhabited shores, when I picture to myself the dense and lofty summits of the forest, unmolested by the axe of the settler, when I see that the vast herds of elk, deer, and buffalo which once pastured on these hills and in these valleys have ceased to exist, when I remember that these extraordinary changes have all taken place in the short period of 20 years, I pause, wonder, and although I know all to be fact, can scarcely believe its reality.
Thank you. The untransacted destiny of the American people is to subdue the continent. To rush over this vast field to the Pacific Ocean. To confirm the destiny of the human race.
There is nothing on the American continent equal to it, folks. Timber, soil, fish, climate, no end to the possibilities of wealth here. An inexhaustible gold mine. Take a train, take a wagon, by golly, walk if you have to.
How beautiful would this natural Eden look if parted off with fences into farms. Dotted with cities, villages, and farmhouses. Each claimant can claim and hold 240 acres of land. My husband, his father, and sister are claimants, making 720 acres of land belonging to our family.
Yes, the Indians are in evidence everywhere. I am told they are harmless, but I do not like the way they have of stalking into the house unbidden or looking in at the windows. I do not like it.
They will not dig the gold or let others do it. They are too lazy and too much like mere animals to cultivate the fertile soil, mine the coal, develop the salt mines, or wash the gold. What shall be done with these Indian dogs in our manger?
The buffalo hunters have done more to settle the vexed Indian question than the entire regular army has done. Because they are destroying the Indians' commissary. Indeed, for the sake of lasting peace, let them kill, skin, and sell until the buffaloes are exterminated. Yes, then your prairies will be covered with your speckled cattle and the festive cowboy.
I rush my horse into them, pick out the fattest cows, shoot them down. Killed for the railroad company for 17 months. During that time, the number I brought into camp was kept account of. 4,280 buffalo. 4,200. 80.
While the slaughter of the buffalo has been, in places, needless and brutal, and while, from a purely selfish standpoint, many, including myself, would rather see it continue to exist, Yet its destruction was a condition precedent upon the advance of white civilization in the West. From the standpoint of humanity at large, the extermination of the buffalo has been a blessing.
Nature has nowhere presented more beautiful and lovely scenes than those of the vast prairies of the West. And if man and beast, no nobler specimens than those who inhabit them. The Indian and the buffalo. Joint and original tenants of the soil. And fugitives together from the approach of civilized man. They have fled to the great plains of the West. And there, under an equal doom, they have taken up their last abode, where their race will expire, and their bones will bleach together.
Inga Dome Cardi.
I love the land and the buffalo and will not part with it. I don't want to settle. I love to roam the prairies. I want the children raised as I was. A long time ago, this land belonged to our fathers. But when I go to the river, I see soldiers in its banks. They cut down our timber. They kill my buffalo. When I see that, it feels as if my heart would burst with sorrow.
History our God has bestowed upon his chosen people. A history of statesmen flung the boundaries of the Republic out into unexplored lands and savage wildernesses. A history of a multiplying people who overran a continent in half a century. Steam joins us. Electricity joins us. The very elements are in league with our destiny.
The final victory of man's machinery over nature's materials is the next logical process in evolution. Machinery, science, and intelligence moving on the face of the earth may well affect it as the elements do, upbuilding, obliterating, and creating, and they are man's forces, and will be used to hasten his dominion over nature. And each gain upon nature adds to the quantity of goods to be consumed by society.
Bigger and better than ever. Oh, what a feeling. You've got me feeling bigger and better than ever. My heart is bumping. You've got it bumping bigger and better than ever. Bigger and better than ever.
Take it on up.
To make 1 ton of steel, 1.5 tons of iron has to be mined, then transported 100 miles from the mine to the lakes, then carried by boat hundreds of miles, and then transported by rail 150 miles again to Pittsburgh. 1.5 tons of coal must be mined, manufactured into coke, and carried 50 miles by rail, and 1 ton of limestone mined and carried to Pittsburgh. Miraculous.
If the businessman's refinery taints the air, if his chimneys smut the sky, if his waste poisons our streams, we tolerate it. Tell him of the forest blighted by the arsenic fumes from giant smelters, and he replies, it would cut dividends to get rid of the fumes. The smoke-laden air of every city, he says, is but a testimonial of the general prosperity of the country.
Win the war. Plant wheat. Plant the cattle ranges. Plant your vacant lots. Plant Wheat! Wheat for the boys over there! Wheat for the Allies! Wheat at any price! Wheat will win the war! Fetch me timber, my son, wherewith to build 1,000 ships. Without ships, the war cannot be won. Without timbers, ships cannot be built. Every swing of an axe, every cut of a saw may score as heavily as a shot fired from the trenches. Help our boys win the war. Make the world safe for democracy.
There has always been, at each decisive period in this world's history, some voice, some note that represented for the time being the prevailing power. First, there was the lion's roar. Then came the voice of man. Now, in the streets of Detroit, the murmur of this newest and most perfect of forces, the automobile.
The way to make an automobile for the great multitudes is to make one just like another. To make them all alike. To make them come through the factory all alike. Just like one pin is just like another. A car so low in price that no man making a good salary will be unable to own one. And when I'm through, about everybody will have one. The horse will disappear from our highway. The automobile will be taken for granted, and there won't be any problem.
Henry Ford, what have you done?
You've got the whole nation talking.
Henry Ford, you sure make 'em run.
Soon there'll be nobody walking.
Of course our agents say we overload them with cars and bully rag them until they have to pull in customers by the ears. But what of it? the average American family is happier and healthier for having a good little car, even if the old man was bluffed into buying it.
I won't give up that car. I'd go without clothes and food before I gave up that car. Well, I'd rather starve.
The story of the development of life and industry in America is the most amazing tale of the waste of wealth by a careless, improvident people that the world has ever known. For every barrel of oil which reaches the pipeline, 3 barrels have been wasted. It may be cheaper today to skim the cream from oil gushers, but our children and our children's children may pay a bitter price.
America has been altered astonishingly. And the changes which have come over us were more swiftly achieved than at any time in our history. We sold more goods to the world in this decade than in the entire 19th century. And we mined 1 billion tons more coal, smelted twice as much copper, made 3.5 times as much steel. We match a decade against a century, and the decade wins.
Industry as a whole can plan and execute for its advancement, secure in the belief that there are no limits to the total productive capacity of the country and the resulting purchasing power. Because there are no limits to the needs and desires of American consumers. Of course, there exists theoretically that danger point when consumption has reached its limit. However, such a breaking point is probably non-existent. Human desires seem to have no limits.
If a man saves $15 a week and invests in good common stocks and allows the dividends to accumulate, at the end of 20 years, he'll be rich. And I am firm in my belief that man not only can be rich, but ought to be rich.
Gosh, wasn't we crazy?
Why, the thought never entered our head that we wasn't the brightest, wisest, and most accomplished people that was ever on this earth. Hadn't we figured out mass production? Couldn't we make more things than anybody? Did the thought ever enter our bone head that the time might come when nobody would want all these things we were making? No. We had it all figured out that the more we made, the more they would want.
Great areas lie devastated beneath a merciless cloud of pulverized soil. It looms like dim, grimy doom and settles in arid layers and desiccated drifts. This was the western prairie grassland. The cowboys grazed their cattle here. Then cultivators came, plowed up the buffalo grass and laid the soil bare to the winds. And now the winds have blown off the topsoil in clouds, in drifts.
We started out in 14 on a rampage such as was never known in the history of agriculture. We went into this thing on the thought of furnishing food and winning the war. It was partly patriotic and partly with the thought of making money. We plowed up 60 million acres of the best land in this country.
Well, we plowed. We plowed because wartime wheat prices said plow. Government said plow. Wife said plow. So we plowed everything. Tore up so easy, we plowed it all.
Years ago, you plow out in the prairie with a woman, kids, and a couple of ponies. Get up a section of land. Yeah, they thought there was no end to that.
America's 2 million miles of rural road, 750,000 miles of surfaced highway, 127 million big machines, motor cars, locomotives, turbines, tractors, trucks, lathes, 700 million installed horsepower. America's 1 million miles of pipeline, electric line, telephone line, 1 billion acres of farmland, 6.5 million farms, 100 million head of stock. half a billion acres of forest. It is incredible anyone should be in want.
Task of diverting the Colorado River through a mile of mountain is almost an accomplished fact. That's dynamite. Hey, look out! The holes are loaded with 3,000 charges before the final pull on the lever, and here she goes!
Technicians today span rivers, plug up canyons, go through mountains. But our future physical progress is going to put the present into the tiniest pygmy class. The public's been told this so many times during the past few years that it does not believe it anymore. They look at our 10 million unemployed and say, there's your progress. We are in the midst of this thing now, and it does not always look like happy landings ahead. But to stop is fatal. To stop our forward progress, even if we could, would hardly lead elsewhere than to a complete wreck. Whether we like it or not, we are on our way.
Fighting machine in action is a thrilling, inspiring sight. Here's another fighting machine in action, producing, not destroying. Producing for the 11 million fighting men of America and their allies.
Steel-jacketed messengers of death. Ammunition factory, one of hundreds engaged in turning out the millions of...
Here is steel, giant builder of the sinews of defense, symbol of democracy's strength. For guns, tanks, ships, planes, trucks...
Long lines of new heavy tanks bear witness to the need for steel and more steel.
Where we used to make hubcaps, now we're making helmets. Mass production, same as before, of the things that count today.
Buttons, switchgear, motors, transformers, turbines, accelerate the defense effort across the continent.
Has left the drafting boards and is now in mass production.
Mass production of the tools of battle.
More production. Faster production. Mobilization of manpower and machines.
That's just 3 days' work standing there.
We won because we were audacious. We have won this war because our men are brave and because of the gift of nature's materials. In the emergency of war, our nation's powers are unbelievable. The strength we have spread around the world is appalling, even to those who make up that strength. I'm sure that in the past 2 years, I've heard soldiers say 1,000 times, if only we could have created all this energy for something good. But we rise above our normal powers only in times of destruction. Made the atomic bomb. We have become the richest people on the globe. We have achieved the highest standard of living known to history. But how will we live? The whole world has an interest in the answers which history will make of these questions.
Every 7.5 seconds, a new baby is born somewhere in the United States.
Now I have children of my
That means every 7 seconds, marketers have gained one new prospect who will need food, clothing, shelter, and later on, motor cars, hi-fi sets, power boats, and a casket. More people means more markets.
I want a Corvette.
I thought you would.
Ooh, I want a Pontiac too.
Okay, we'll have the usual two-car garage.
The population explosion is a grand thing for business. Think of all the machines we can sell to more people. The consumer is a great big gaping jaw we're all trying to fill up with whatever we can cram down there. And the great hope is that the jaw will keep getting wider and wider. We can make it an American middle class universe. And we can make a lot of money on it.
Bobbles, bangles, hear how they ring, jingling, the bobbles. Bangles, bright shiny beads, sparkles, spangles, her heart will ring, jingling-a-ling-a wearing baubles, bangles and beads, she'll glitter and gleam, so make somebody dream, so that...
All you have to know is... what switch to turn, what buttons to push, and what cans to buy.
Our canned foods are the best in the world, and look at the variety. Packaged cereal, prepared mixes, frozen foods. Well, these peas may have been picked last June when they were just perfect. Grandmother would call this a miracle.
Ladies and gentlemen, here they are.
Our enormously productive economy demands that we make consumption our way of life. That we convert the buying and use of goods into rituals. That we seek our spiritual satisfaction, our ego satisfaction, in consumption.
Mother, wouldn't it be slick if we had an electric ironer, like Sally's mother has?
Of course it would. And I'm looking forward to having an electric dryer, too.
Whee!
No matter what the job is, there are machines to take the hard work out of it.
It's no trick to do the wash with this baby, and we can go right on playing cribbage.
Automatic, huh?
Oh, you betcha.
Pennsylvania, America's first full-scale atomic power plant devoted exclusively to civilian use goes into operation. In the White House, President Eisenhower waves a radioactive wand to send the plant into full-scale operation, and nearly a quarter of a million kilowatts of power feed into the lines. Hundreds of thousands of homes, businesses, and factories are supplied from the pioneering installation. Peacetime atomic energy truly comes of age.
The atom will give us all the power we need and more. Power seemingly without end. Power to do everything man is destined to do. We have found what might be called perpetual youth, the hope and exuberance of boundless energy.
We've heard so much about the success of the epic effort to harness the atom. We often delude ourselves into thinking that we have altogether conquered it. But perhaps we've adjusted to the fact of atomic energy too fast for our own good. I am not sure that we fully realize what kind of power we're holding in our hands.
With every explosion of a superbomb, huge quantities of radioactive material are pumped into the air. Something called strontium 90. Which is the most dreadful poison in the world. In sufficient concentration, it can cause prior to the atomic age, radioactive strontium was practically non-existent in the world. Today, all of us, all over
still talk in terms of conquest. We still haven't become mature enough to think of ourselves as only a tiny part of a vast and incredible universe. Man's attitude toward nature is today critically important, simply because we have now acquired a fateful power to alter and destroy nature. But man is a part of nature, and his war against nature is inevitably a war against himself. Now, I truly believe that we in this generation must come to terms with nature. And I think we're challenged as mankind has never been challenged before, to prove our maturity and our mastery, not of nature, but of ourselves.
We have reached the moon, but we have not yet reached each other. I do not wish to seem overdramatic, but the members of the United Nations have perhaps 10 years left to subordinate their ancient quarrels and launch a global partnership to improve the human environment, to diffuse the population explosion. If such a global partnership is not forged within the next decade, then I very much fear that the problems I have mentioned will be beyond our capacity to control.
Hundreds of birds, mostly ducks, are being washed ashore on the island of Martha's Vineyard off the coast of Massachusetts. Their feathers are covered with heavy crude oil, picked up in a 7-mile-long oil slick just offshore. The waterfowl, by the hundreds, are dying.
The National Lead Company's titanium oxide plant in St. Louis covers 40 acres and has 140 smokestacks.
Some of this pollution does consist of acid mist. I have seen our secretary come in with her nylon stockings in shreds from the acid mist.
Now, yesterday was one of the smoggiest days on record in the Los Angeles area. People here didn't need statistics to tell them the air quality was wretched. The city suffocated under the hot brown blanket.
Devices attached to the inside of smokestacks, but what results is a huge quantity of sludge. No one has figured out what to do with
it. Logging companies that have been clear-cutting rainforests at the rate of 3 square miles a day.
PCBs are valuable to industry, but they're also poisonous.
Scientists see the fluorocarbons floating into the atmosphere deplete the ozone layer.
Plutonium, buried just 7 years ago, leaked out of its containers and seeped into the...
Chemical wastes are this ship's wake. This ship is just dumping them as it goes along.
The beach are fouled with oily glop that's 2 inches thick.
Contaminated with high amounts of DDT. Some fish with...
Now there are no fish, no rubber bottoms.
And kept on rolling the barrels of radioactive waste into the sea.
It's called acid rain.
Chemical seepage.
Radioactive waste.
Illegal dumping of toxic waste.
Treated for chemical inhalation.
Dangerous for thousands of years.
Greenhouse effect.
Huge cloud of black smoke carrying toxic fuel.
Nobody knows what to do.
There are no boundaries on planet Earth. Not only have we failed to realize we are one people, we have forgotten that we have only one planet. The slow dismemberment of the Earth is not a recent development. Our early forebears began the process thousands of years ago. The difference is simple. Today, we have nowhere else to go.
Compare the 6 days of the Book of Genesis to the 4 billion years of geologic time. On this scale, 1 day equals about 666 million years. All day Monday until Tuesday noon, creation was busy getting the Earth going. Life began on Tuesday noon, and the beautiful organic wholeness of it developed over the next 4 days. At 4 p.m. Saturday, the big reptiles came. 5 hours later, when the redwoods appeared, there were no more big reptiles. At 3 minutes before midnight, man appeared. 1/4 of a second before midnight, Christ arrived. At 1/40 of a second before midnight, the Industrial Revolution began. We are surrounded by people who think that what we have been doing for 1/40 of a second can go on indefinitely. They are considered normal. But they are stark, raving mad.
Ah, Majesty. Rivers, Majesty, filled with gold.
Go forth, children. Multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it.
And we shall be the place where the Lord will create a new heaven and a new earth.
The final victory of man's machinery over nature's materials is the next logical process in evolution.
But man is a part of nature, and his war against nature is inevitably a war against himself.
I pause. Wonder, and although I know all to be fact, can scarcely believe its reality. Not only have we failed to realize we are one people, we have forgotten that we have only one planet.
I looked below me, where the earth was silent in a sick green light. And saw the hills look up, afraid. And all the animals. And everywhere about me were the cries of frightened birds and the sounds of fleeing wings. Then I was standing on the highest mountain of them all, and round about beneath me was the whole hoop of the world. Stood there. I saw more than I can tell, and I understood more than I saw. For I was seeing in a sacred manner the shapes of all things in the spirit, and the shape of all shapes as they must live together like one being. I saw that it was holy.